on this program are those of the host or guest and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please?
I'm saying boogie woogie 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 woogie. That's what I'm saying. Boogie woogie.
Damn good coffee and hot.
It's okay, coffee. Kinda hot. And the screen just stays up too long every single day. But that's okay, I guess. Good morning, people of Earth. Today feels like a Thursday, probably a Thursday, August 18th, 2022. I don't know. Does it feel like a Thursday to you? Almost done with this crazy week, but no. Even when we're done with this crazy week, the week gets crazier. This thing Saturday looks like it might be some fun. Now, remember, it's important to remember that it's not about fun. It's about raising money for Christine Levine. Yeah, you know, I didn't even check where the GoFundMe is. Let me see where we're at now. GoFund. Christine, where are you? We are 16,802. Listen, we might break 20,000 by the time the show starts. We're looking to go to 25,000. Of course, she got the discount cancer from Walmart. So it's a little cheaper than Andy's cancer. But we might be almost there by the time this thing starts. Thing is looking like it might be fun though. And when the idea was first approached, it's like, oh no, this again, this is a lot of work. And it has been a lot of work, thanks to people like Dean O'Hara for really pitching in and helping out. Of course, Carl and Jamie, their work, real work. I know Carl has done the flyers and the spreadsheet and all that stuff, but the real work for them starts Saturday afternoon for them. Now, things are shaping up. I should hear back from several heavy hitters today about the possibility of being on the podcast. I'm excited for certain possibilities that have opened up. We are, as I mentioned yesterday, with Doug Stanhope, I kind of expected late last minute he would jump in, just as he did with Andy's thing, because I wasn't expecting him on Andy's Podathon. And then the last moment, actually, Christine Levine helped secure that. And then he wrote to me and said, when do you need me on? And then he was willing to come on whenever. So I was kind of expecting that anyway. We heard from him last night. Thanks to Dean and Tom for kind of getting the greasing the wheels a little bit on that. So Stanhope's got a full schedule of UK interviews for the day on Saturday, and his plane only gets in at 1 a.m. Saturday morning, and he's probably going to be, he said to me, he's probably going to be a little hungover, or he just said hungover. So I'm thinking the later one, the 7 p.m. slot where Andy comes back, would be perfect for him, because by that time, the UK interviews will definitely be done. It will be past midnight there in the UK. He will be in Grand Rapids, Michigan, so it'll be 7 o'clock his time. Probably whatever hangover he had will be gone by 7 p.m. So that's looking good. I did reach out to the one and only Tim Dillon. Now, I haven't heard back, but I'm expecting I might hear back today. But certainly, I'm just putting this out there, and I'm not asking people to wink, wink, say something to him on Twitter, like, hey, you should do that podcast, Podathon, whatever. But it couldn't hurt. would be amazing if you know, to get him on it as well. And there's some other people who I've reached out to who might be getting back to me today. This thing is looking like it's going to be fun. But it also is looking like it's going to be a clusterfuck because almost everybody, not everybody, but almost everybody, doesn't want to be really pinned down to a time. I'll be there about this time. I'll be there about that time. So things are going to run into each other. I think some of my plans for having stuff like Henry and Hack Oddity doing a cooking competition for a simple dish, the logistics of that, and we'd have to time it. They have to both get there at the same time. They both have agreed to come on at the same time. We haven't really talked about. I did mention the idea of having them demonstrate one simple thing together as a kind of challenge, see who did it better, and maybe I would do it along at here in the studio. But that might be a nightmare. Now, you'll see who's in the chat room. I see some people are in the chat room. Hold on. Good morning, Dean. Good morning, Craig. Good morning, William. And that's all who's in the chat room so far. I don't know why I'm seeing 18 people when I only see 4 people in there, 3 people. Anyway, so William Conway, speak of the devil, and I am talking about the devil. Will is planning on doing a man on the street in Albuquerque. Good morning, Kelly. A man on the street, short segments on the hour in the early afternoon in Albuquerque. Now, we have not prepared any questions for him. I think something like Jamie and Carl, my comedians, real comedians who are hosting this thing, should probably help out, come up with a few questions for William in case I don't want my brother coming out of that bedroom with just his dick in his hands. That kind of thing. Whatever. But that should be interesting. That should be fun. Something a little different. Got a lot of musical guests coming on. Thanks to Dean, we got Victoria Williams, who's had one of her songs actually covered by Pearl Jam. Very cool thing. Very cool thing. Got a number of Mishka Shubali, as long as I continue to pronounce his name right and type it right. We'll be doing a couple of songs, premiering a couple of new songs, which is kind of a big deal. The Rockin' 45s, we'll be doing some original music, acoustic music, with the old-timey, I'm thinking right now, it's looking like the old-timey setup in front of a live audience for the streaming thing. We'll be doing 3 original songs with Bill on stand-up bass, me on acoustic guitar, and Mikey out front. Just that small stripped-down, old-timey thing. So it's looking like it could be fun. And as I mentioned, we've got some heavy hitters who are possibly lined up. Today at 10 a.m., Matt Balaker, who has written the Greg Giraldo book, A Comedian Story, will be with me. Something different. We're going to be talking to an author. Generally, authors are for the evening show. But I'll be talking to an author today. But because of the subject matter, Greg Giraldo, I thought it was a good fit for the morning show. And he's out in L.A. very early for him. But it'd be great to get some cool stories about Greg Giraldo, what went into the book. I understand Colin Quinn has written the foreword for the book, and he interviewed lots of stand-ups, people who were friends with Giraldo, for the book. So it should be an interesting conversation. What is William saying? It rains so much where I live in Grants. Anything like about anything that the Zunis get, we get. The Zunis is, I guess, mountains. I don't know. The Zunis. I don't know any Zunis. So I hope it doesn't rain on Saturday. If it rains, that could. Oh, Kelly. By the way, where's my dry cleaning? PT 1490. Your dry cleaning is ready. PT1490, your dry cleaning is ready. Get it now. Yes, mountains, he says. But go to Kansas City, William. Your dry cleaning is ready for pickup. PT1490. Anyway, your dry cleaning's ready. We got the cum stains out of the collar, but could not get the shit stains out of your pants, because you probably should have wore some underwear anyway, you crazy bastard. So that's the show today. No guest co-host today. We're kind of weaning back into the world. Listen, I was never supposed to have a co-host anyway. When I signed up with Kiera, it was only to be 5-minute segments every hour of news, weather, you know, and then evolved into happy news, silly happy news. And then eventually, I don't know what happened, just ended up she would come in and just stay once she got in. I'm on the last legs of COVID. Now, I don't have COVID anymore. I tested negative, but still got a little bit of the sniffles and the voice thing going on anyway. Kelly says, I lost it because I've been tweeting and retweeting. What have you been tweeting and retweeting? Stop retweeting and tweeting and tweeting and tweeting. And just concentrate on your job. Get your job right. Who's paying you? Is Twitter paying you? Is that mind dog asshole paying you, or is Harvey's dry cleaning service in Kansas City Mo paying you? Harvey's dry cleaning service. It's for big rabbits only. There is probably some poison in this coffee or something. Excuse me. As I said last night, if I say anything, it's the COVID talking. But that's what that's where we are at now. Let me look at the sheet and see what we're looking at here. It's almost $17,000 for has been raised so far without us even doing a show. So we don't even have to do a show. We just get to the point where people pledge all the money, and then we can just we got enough money. Show's canceled. So Jeff Dwoskin will be with us. Andy will be with us in the morning. Don Sill and Joey Cola will be with us to talk about a new film, a comedy film that Don Sill has put together. Now, there's been so much talk about movies that really don't get it right with respect to stand-up comedy. Now, Don Sill's film that is coming out, it's a self-produced thing that was shot almost entirely at Governor's Comedy Clubs, with the exception of one scene where Joey Cola is playing his manager, and that was shot in an office scene somewhere. So, but most of it is actual comedy scene footage, and of course it was written, produced, and directed by a real stand-up comic. So I'm expecting this film to be okay. As far as one of the good ones, as far as portraying the truth about stand-up comedy. We shall see, and we'll learn a little bit more about it. Matt Knudsen will be with us as well. Mishka Shubali, as I previously mentioned. John Pavaramo, Tom Bannis, Billy Wayne Davis, Henry Phillips, Hack Oddity, all both at the same time. Jackie Martling, Victoria Williams, as I mentioned, the Rockin' 45s old-timey set. Tony and Sally from Governor's Podcast, Drop Dead Radio. Carlos Valencia. Then Andy again at 7 p.m. Derek Sheen says he will make it towards the end. He's got some issues going on with family stuff. Brett Brock will not be here because he's got family issues going on, or people family visiting him. Our beloved Kat will not be with us because she's got some family things going on as well. So that's a couple of downers on the end there. Sorry about that. I hate to be a downer. And of course, as I mentioned at the start, there's a strong possibility now that Stanhope will be joining us. Again, if you missed what I said in the beginning, I did reach out to the one and only Tim Dillon through email. I am expecting him to get that and respond. I do think that now I'm not necessarily saying he will respond positively, but what I am not urging people to do, wink, wink, is maybe tweet at him, not tag him in a tweet, but and I'm not urging you to do this, wink, wink, to maybe just tweet at him, hey, is there a possibility you might be on that pod-a-thon thing? We're hearing a nasty rumor that you might be on that pod-a-thon thing. Wink, wink. We're not hearing any kind of rumors that you're going to, whatever. Yeah, peer pressure never hurts anybody. I mean, wink, wink, it does. Dean did not secure Doug Stanhope. He's not secure at all. Dean opened the door for it. Good job, Dean. But he's not secure. Don't say secure. You'll jinx it. Go back to your dry cleaning, woman. You're jinxing the whole show over here. No, I appreciate it. We love Dean, and you're absolutely right. Dean deserves a lot of credit for helping make open the door to possibly securing Stanhope. That's what he does. So thank you. Now go back to your dry cleaning, woman. I'm just kidding. Anyway, don't be a jinx. You're like a friggin' Met fan over here, jinxing stuff. You're counting your championship trophies before you ever win a game. That's what you're like, Kelly. You're a Met fan. You shouldn't even be a Kansas City fan. You should be a Royals fan, but no, you're like a Met fan. Jinx City. Yeah, don't mess it up, Dean. Carl's right. Don't mess it up. He almost messed it up. Did you see that? He almost messed it up big time. Because when he called me and told me that it was a possibility, I said, well, send them the information. He posted the link on Twitter, the link to the backstage, so that the entire world was now invited backstage for the show. Quickly rectified that, and then I sent Stanhope an email, and he got right back to me, and he said that just to remind him on Saturday. But I'm thinking it's can you please not abuse me while customers are here? Now, how am I supposed to know when customers are there? All right, let me know when the customers leave, and then we'll turn up the abuse. William is a Cubs fan. What the hell? Cubs are on a terror since the All-Star break. Too bad we're still 16 games back. Now, how could you be a Cubs fan in Grants, New Mexico, or Sioux Falls, Idaho, or whatever? Why Cubs of all? Yeah. Get some headphones, Kelly, so we can abuse it while customers are there. I don't see why this should not be an excuse for getting out of abuse. Customers. No, I have not seen the Royals lately. I've never seen the Royals in my life, to be honest with you. I have never, Kelly's asking if I've ever seen the Royals lately. I have never seen the Royals. Carl and Jamie see the Royals all the time because they are royal subjects. Look at this. I can't, my thing is broke. I can't show comments. Look at that. Grew up in Iowa. So if you grew up in Iowa, you should be a fan of who? Shoeless Joe Jackson. A Field of Dreams. Aren't they playing a game out there in Iowa like soon, like this week or something? Wasn't there supposed to be something going on this week with the Field of Dreams thing? I know there were plans for that. I just haven't been following. Iowa has no pro team. I know that. But they do have... why? My comments are not working. The AA team is the Cubs. So there's a AAA team. out there, Cubs minor leagues. Easy, Matt. Go Cubs, go. Wait, now, oh, Craig is originally from Chicago. That makes sense. Well, that at least makes sense. He's from Chicago. He says, Easy, Matt, go Cubs, go. $100 will get you $25,000. $250,000 if they win the World Series. I did not know that, but that ain't gonna happen. You know that. Dean says he gets abused all the time, but he gives it back. Well, gives him to Kelly. Let me see. You could do it in the chat room because the customers won't hear. You guys could abuse her all you want. So let me see what you got, Dean. Abuse Kelly a little bit. Let's see. Let's watch. How this unfolds. My customers would agree with the abuse anyway. Oh, so you got unruly Kansas City mobsters, Dutch Schultz mob coming in there. I get it. Anyway, what the hell am I talking about? Again, at 10 a.m., Matt Balaker, author of the Greg Giraldo comedian story, I'm looking forward to this conversation. He'll be with us, and we'll see how that goes. Tomorrow, Jackie the Joke Man will be back with me. Haven't talked to Jackie in about 2 months now. Just about 2 months. I know he's back working. He did a weekend with Lenny Clark up in Boston last week, and I was waiting for him to get healthy again before having him back on the show. Now, I think Jess will be with me tomorrow. I'm not sure about that yet. Never sure until late Thursday night when I know that she doesn't have like an audition or a film shoot, commercial shoot, or something like that to do. But she will be, I'm 99.9% certain Jess will be on the Podathon on Saturday helping out with that. Forgot to even include her on the sheet. Got to put her on the sheet because she's co-hosting sort of some segments, and rather than not, she's not a guest per se. Oh, I forgot Uncle Walt will be dropping in probably for some of that. Walt's a fun guy. He was on yesterday, and I'm looking for some big things from Walt. He's got some good ideas. I like his approach to comedy. I love his attitude about what it is and the fact that he's going balls to the wall to make it happen, not sitting back and waiting for the comedy world to come knocking on his door. Kelly ain't abusing me. You should hear what she says about you, Dean. I can't even repeat the things she says. When you're not around, she abuses the hell out of you. So that's wrong. You really should give it back. Give it back to her hard. She likes it when you give it to her hard. At least that's what I'm told by the Kansas City Royals. The entire team told me that. Anyway, oh God, you better warn her. Who's her? Oh. What, Jess? About Jackie? What do you mean? I don't know what you're saying to me. See, this is why they should have voice chat over there so I can understand what the hell you mean. I don't know how that would be any different. Anyway, I'm assuming Dean's not your buddy. That's not what you said in private when Dean wasn't around. You were trashing him all night long last night. I mean, it must have got like 40 DMs about how you hate Dean and Dean this and Dean that. I'll show you abuse. Listen, if anybody wants to pop in and hang out until Greg Giraldo, Matt Balaker, if Greg Giraldo shows up, I'll cancel the podathon completely. I'll be like, you know what? Jackie is a bit much with the ladies. Oh, really? Now, that's you saying that. I think they can handle it. Listen, Kiara, I don't want to use the word prude. I'm not going to use the word prude. But Christian, hardcore Christian, she put up with Jackie pretty well. So I don't think Jackie's that hard on the ladies. He's more hard on me. You should see the text he sends me. Now you're changing your tune. Dean is saying he likes a little abuse. Now, you want to come in, Dean? I'll send you a link. Hold on. Let me get you. How do I get you a link again? Oh, yeah. On Twitter, right? Yes. Don't post this all over creation. Okay? All right. Where are you, Dean? There you are. All right. I'm sending you a link on Twitter. Go check your Twitter DMs. You want to pop in. Don't you have your cleaning lady coming in? Now, what we learned on yesterday's program was that Dean bangs cocktail waitresses two at a time, which is it's pretty impressive. You know, we like to think of Fredo as kind of a loser in The Godfather, but he was banging cocktail waitresses two at a time. You only got one. You're banging two at a time. Talent, I think. Anyway, before Dean gets in, I'm going to play today's commercial. I'll be right back with you because I have to take care of some nose maintenance anyway with this damn COVID stuff. So let me just play the True Fire commercial. True Fire, learn how to play guitar, will you, folks? I need a guitar player, so learn. Come on, get on the ball here.
Over 2 million guitar players worldwide learn, practice, and play with True Fire. Our learning tools and massive library of video lessons will ignite your technical skills, harmonic knowledge, rhythm playing, and soloing chops. True Fire's educators are the best in the biz, from Grammy Award winners to world-renowned artists. You'll have access to an unparalleled faculty of over 300 top-notch blues, rock, jazz, country, fingerstyle, and acoustic guitar educators. Using our desktop and mobile apps, you'll work with True Fire's multi-angle video lessons on any device, anytime, anywhere. Integrated learning tools such as video synced tab and notation, slow-mo, looping, practice jam tracks, and many more handy controls accelerate your learning experience. True Fire style-specific learning paths guide you every step of the way. Use our assessment tools to find your starting point, then follow our lesson recommendations and track your progress as you work through your personalized True Fire study plan. Progress faster with private one-on-one instruction, group lessons, multi-track video jams, live streams, song lessons, student forums, True Fire's Riff magazine, premium jam tracks, and much, much more. With thousands of five-star ratings and reviews from amateur and pro players alike, you'll find yourself in good company with the world's most comprehensive guitar learning platform. Grab your guitar and ignite your musicality. Sign up free for an all-access trial today.
Yeah, baby. You know, looks like Dean forgot his Fangol flat cap today, so it might be a little bit dangerous here for the ladies. The ladies will see his head get a little hot under the collar, you know, because Dean is kind of a stud, and the ladies can't resist him. I'm just finding out about this, but he's here now. Let's welcome Dean in again with the scout. Again with the scowl. You come on here like looking like angry all the time.
I always got the resting screw face.
Yeah.
It's like the male version of the resting bitch face, right? Yeah.
Yeah. You know, William Conway was whipped publicly in Sturgis. That talking about abuse. Whipped.
Did he do it? Was it like a kink? Was it something he did for his own?
I think he likes it. I think he's an S&M boy or something. He probably... Yeah, go ahead.
Mildly submissive.
Wow. So, but I was thinking that William is probably a customer of enticeme.com where you can get your toxic-free butt plugs and vibrators and things. Because if anybody who likes being whipped, come on. Kelly likes a little spanking now. Look at all the freaks we got in this chat room.
Yeah, I bring it out. It's my fault.
It is. You are a fucking, I don't know, a perv.
Not a perv.
I'm perv. No, I'm just calling you a perv. I'm a perv encourager. A perv, I don't know.
I'm a mind opener encourager. That's what I am.
All right. Were you a fan of Greg Giraldo?
I don't know them.
You don't know Greg Giraldo? Wow. Mm. I thought you were a student of comedy. Greg Giraldo's one of, I think, one of the top comedians of maybe the last 40 years or so. He died of a heroin overdose. He did a lot of roasts. He was big on the roasts. But no, I was a huge fan. I'm surprised you don't know him.
I don't know everything.
Heroin's a bitch. I really thought you knew everything.
Heroin's a bitch. I've had a lot of friends die from that too.
Yeah. Congratulations on opening the door for this Stanhope thing. You did not secure it.
I'm out of it now because I don't have a line of communication. I'm done.
Yeah, right. And he did write back to me, and he said, just remind me on Saturday. So it looks like we're going to get him, but it's not been confirmed yet.
No, but everybody else you asked me for, I got Mishka, I got Billy Wayne.
You got people we didn't even ask you for. So congratulations on that. You got
Victoria Williams. Yeah. She is. Hey, Carl, what's up?
Hey, Dick.
Carl doesn't talk much. He's very quiet. No, eating and drinking.
I don't want to come in and interrupt in the flow. I was just in the background.
There is no flow. It's just Dean being a fucking pervert. It's just Dean being a fucking pervert.
This is my fucking show.
He's just like butt plugging and beating people and whipping them.
Me?
Yes.
Or combo.
Did you realize?
Yeah, but it looks like the lineup's going to be quite good.
Was
it Potathon?
What would you just say? I'm sorry, I missed that.
It's going to be a good lineup.
I think it'll be fun. Yeah, it should be fun. But it is going to be a clusterfuck because, as I said, so many.
What about the old BW? Can we ask him?
Yes. Yes.
I don't have a line on that guy, but.
All right, I'll ask.
Brendan Walsh. Yep.
Yeah, I think Brendan would do it. I didn't want to. My reluctance is I don't want to overtax my favor card with any of these people because I do still have a show to run after this thing is over, and I don't want them to say, didn't you just ask me for the fucking Potathon? You pain in the ass. I'm doing this all. You're always asking me for shit. And you're never giving. I don't want that.
Way more of these losers are going to get cancer anyway, so there'll be plenty of opportunity to get, you know.
We're all going to get cancer.
Yeah, hopefully.
What do you mean, hopefully? What kind of thing is that to say? No, that's the worst way to go. I wouldn't, to be honest with you, I had a friend who died last year in his sleep. He was my age, and he didn't even know he had anything wrong with him. He just went to sleep.
Yeah, but did he have witnesses? Because when people say they die in their sleep, did they though? Or did they wake up in excruciating pain for hours and no one knew and then they went back to sleep?
That's a good point. I don't know. Nobody was watching him in the middle of
when
the
night. I was a small kid and I thought of that. Like my mum said, oh, they died in their sleep. And I remember being about 10 years old thinking, well, how do you know?
So you're like a prodigy of death. You were a small kid.
No, so much of my family died of cancer. I take it seriously.
Me too.
Well, they say cancer runs in families. Every single person in my family got cancer. My brother didn't die of it. My brother's been dealing with the same cancer Andy has for 22 years now. And the doctors can't believe, like, why are you not dead? He's not only not dead, he feels great. He looks great.
My mother died at 56 from cancer. So
almost my entire family died of cancer. All my uncles, my grandparents, most of my grandparents, I think. I'll still make cancer jokes until the end.
Yeah, Mike Zinn, who we don't know if he's going to be part of the show. He said he said, Dean, turn your camera sideways, or Mike Zinn is going to come to New York City and punch you in your bald head.
Come on here, motherfucker.
All right, Dean, giving it back to that bully, so Mike Zinn.
Dean will cut you. Dean's in the Bronx. He's got to cut bitches every day out on the streets.
Yeah, I'm the knife man. Yeah.
You got a gun knife? Yeah, did you get one of those gun knives like they attacked Chappelle with?
No, I don't have a knife, but I have like a necklace. Of a knife.
So Dean reached out to Olivia Grace, which was good, but
no, I didn't, because I couldn't write her. I'm not able to write her. I wanted to write her and Morgan Murphy.
Oh, so what did you do? You just tweeted at
them? Email them.
Emailed them. Okay. Yeah, you know, she has responded to emails in the past, and she did say she at some point, she like 2 years ago, she would do the show, but she has had some health issues of her own and stress and all that stuff. Morgan Murphy, I don't even know how to get in touch with Morgan Murphy. You found an email for her?
No, I haven't. That's the problem.
Yeah. I think we got a full schedule, and especially if these people today confirm, if any of them do, we got a full schedule. The problem is going to be being a traffic cop for all this thing, because again, probably about 80% of them don't want to be totally nailed down to a time. I'll be in around 1 o'clock. I'll be in around 2 o'clock. It could be a real...
But we'll just see what happens. There'll be some people who need to go. Some people want to hang around and it'll be better. Just see what it's like for the flow. If there's 100 people on the screen and there's someone being annoying, they can go. Right. Or if it's just flowing, we can just sit back and be quiet and let three other people talk.
Yeah.
Well, if you want me, Matt, to like remind people during the day who I've been in contact with, I can do that.
Yeah, that would be cool. So are you gonna host the Victoria Williams thing?
Well, it's all up to you guys. I'm not in charge. I'll host whatever you guys want me to host.
I think that would be cool if you hosted that, since you know her. I mean, we'll be on standby in case you need us, and like you have any.
In case you fuck it up, Victoria Williams needs to come in.
Yeah, I can host Victoria Williams. Yeah, she's been my friend for over 20 years.
All right. Did I ask you something inappropriate about her yesterday? Yeah, I did. You told, and you shut me down. Well,
Don't bring it up on air. Oh, it was on air. Okay.
It was on air. Yes. Ready? Shut me.
Did you say anything about her inappropriate about Victoria Williams?
I did. I think you shut me down because I asked if you ever had sex with her. I think I asked that.
No, that's inappropriate, man. Come on.
I know. That's what you said. That's what you said yesterday. What time do you
want
me to come on?
Most people just say no.
What time do we want in on? 8:15.
In the morning. I am.
No, that's a little too early.
We've got 9:30. We've got 11. But with it, you know, whatever.
There you go.
In the morning.
You know what? 11 a.m. is looking good right now, but Tommy Chong might take that. I'm hoping I'm going to hear from
Tommy. What time is Tommy coming on again? He's coming on.
Flow ruiner. Tommy Chong's going to be high and pretending to us he didn't have sex with men in prison. So
yeah,
just come on whenever you like.
He's coming on at 9. Andy Andrew.
Yeah.
9 o'clock.
Yeah, Andy is at 9 and then 7. So I'm thinking, because I didn't even mention Brett, because Brett is coming on with Andy. I'm thinking at 7, it actually looks like we might get a mini issues with Andy, and maybe,
Andy told me they have like a 15-minute like clip from issues of Andy's they want to play too.
Oh,
yeah.
But
he's
yeah,
all the news.
The problem is Andy is managing this whole thing.
No, I'll be on Andy. I'll do it. I'll do it.
Yeah, somebody needs to manage Andy if he's managing things.
Because Andy's in charge of Brett, and I'm like, shouldn't it be the opposite way?
Kevin, what time should Kevin come on? Because I just want to acknowledge Kevin for, well, I want to blame Kevin, but everybody else should give him some credit for this. But for me, it's for blame for me, credit for everybody else. But we should have Kevin on just for a couple minutes to kind of acknowledge him, and so I can curse him out for doing this to us.
For sure.
And that everybody else can thank him for doing this.
Tagging people publicly where you can't say no, can't say, oh, for God's sake, I'm feeling a bit tired. I don't want to do anything for this one.
Right.
And then you go, well, I have to. It's been out there publicly now. So.
Right. So what time would be a good time for Kevin? I'm thinking like midday maybe. And what is Oklahoma? Is that Central Time? I don't even fucking know. Mountain Time? I think it's Central Time.
I think it's Central, just barely.
How about like 4:30 Eastern Time, whatever that turns into, wherever the hell Oklahoma is. Oklahoma's Central, I think, right?
Well, I think, yeah, give him, I think he's, he was saying he's at the lake or something, so.
Yeah.
Let's see when he's traveling.
So we got Mishka 4 and Victoria 5.
Mishka at 1. Not 4. Yeah. You got it backwards. He's at 1, which is not 4 o'clock his time. It's actually 10 o'clock, 10 a.m. his time.
Oh, okay.
Mishka at 1 p.m. Eastern. Mike said if you could fit in somewhere in the morning around 10:45, 11 o'clock, somewhere at that. All that stuff is wide open right now if you want to come on. At that time, if you can make it.
We got to get Kristen Becker on, though. We got to do that.
Got to do what?
Kristen Becker.
Oh, yeah. She still hasn't given me a time. She said she wants to do it. She's pretty sure she can do it. Let me see about my schedule, but she never got back to me. I'm assuming she's going to be part of it. But again, here we go.
11 o'clock is Billy Wayne Davis, right? I think so.
Yes.
No, 2 o'clock Eastern time. 11 o'clock Pacific time.
Well, let's not read the entire schedule out on the show.
Sorry.
All right, get this comment.
I'm fucking.
Get this comment off the screen.
I'll get rid of it. There we go.
No, actually, don't fuck with Dean because Dean is the new boss in town. He's got a whip, and he's not afraid to use it. He's a whip and a knife. He has. Look at the scowl on this fucking kid. Look at him.
I know.
He always looks angry.
And I have Russian school face.
This is how Dean comes onto the show.
Yeah.
Yep.
He's going, I'll cut you. I like it. I'm not criticizing. I like it.
No, he's a badass. He's a badass gangster. The gangster of the Bronx. He's the badass of the Bronx. Anyway,
how many badasses in the Bronx?
So, Carl, were you a fan of Greg Giraldo, or am I the only Greg Giraldo fan here today?
I'm aware of Giraldo, yeah, but I haven't particularly gone through his stuff that much. I'm not a massive fan as yet, but he's one of those people that I'll probably dive into and do everything. Longer term, no. But
let's see if we can get you a free copy of the book. Get Matt to send you a free copy of the book for the show.
Let's get the match.
Yeah. Colin Quinn, you know him. He did the foreword for the book.
Nice.
Yeah, so I'm pretty, you know, I thought everybody was a huge fan of Greg Giraldo. I'm shocked. How about the chat room? People over there? People over in the chat room.
Kelly's got the book.
She has the book. Oh, she's got the book. Well, share and share alike. What is the show schedule? She's asking. Well, that's for us to know and for you.
Are we going to get Chrissy on with the snakes?
I don't think there's time for it. And I would be open to it. I don't know. What do you guys think? Do you think you want to do that?
I'm
Listen, we need more females. I know we have more than last time, but we need more females because we don't want to be known as the guy.
The misogynist comedians, right? No.
Right.
Yeah, it's not the Sausage Club. Saturday Sausage Club.
And Christina's a hottie, so it would be good just for, even if we don't even look at the snakes, just to have her on. That is a misogynist thing to say, but I think I'm right. I think
I wish we had a line on Morgan Murphy.
We need some eye candy. Well, Morgan Murphy would be great to, if we could get her on. She just doesn't respond to any.
She can't email them if they don't follow you. That's the thing.
I'm finding that a lot of comedians don't really like humans.
Yeah, I know. That's part of the misanthropic. Yeah,
they don't like people. Carl, I noticed you got your background back up there.
Well, it's starting to take shape. By Saturday, I'm going to be pretty well set up, I think. So
I'm thinking about doing some changes to the studio for Saturday as well. Just to kind of, I did put my smokestack PA back up because. Nice. But I'll be doing some other things, I think, or aesthetic change if I have time to. I got a lot of stuff doing a. Text messages coming in. Uh-oh. I hate when that happens during the show.
Guys, if you need any more help, let me know. I'll try to do anything I can.
I know that. You're a trooper, Dean. You're an amazing asset to the program, and I'm fine. And I'm not just saying that because I'm goofing around or trying to be silly here. I'm really grateful to have gotten you involved with everything, and you're a great guy, and I appreciate you very much.
Thanks. I mean, I have booking experience because of punk concerts, DJ gigs, whatever. So I know how to talk to people.
Yeah. That's it. But we're not gonna let you fuck all the women. So get that out of your mind, you dirty.
You can have half. You can have half.
No, women. It's only you, dog, who brings it dirty.
He's a snapback fucker, isn't he? He's a snapback fucker. Anyway, so it's looking like it's gonna be fun this weekend. I don't know. We'll see what happens. So, in terms of women, though, who do we have? We got Victoria Williams. We got Jess. Who else we got right now?
I'm saying about Olivia Grace and Morgan Murphy.
Yeah, we definitely. Tony's wife, that's it. Three women on the show.
We'll do better.
Yeah. We got to do some reaching out today. I will, but also, and I'm just putting this out there one more time that I'm not suggesting, because I know some comedians hate this. I'm not suggesting. Well, I just want to say that Becker, when we brought that, because last Potathon, Stanhope said, you got to get some women on here. And I said, what about Kristen Becker? He said, she's a dude. So. That's that. I'm not suggesting that people, I don't know, ambushed him, Dylan. But if anybody is out there listening who might want to tweet at him and say, hey, I didn't hear a nasty rumor that you won't be on the Potathon, check your email.
I'm done with the harassment of comedians, so you have to find someone else.
Yeah, I know. No, I was putting this out there for anybody who's out there listening who might not be associated with the show. We don't actually. It would be better if somebody who is not associated with us at all, just some random listener, hearing me and going and tweeting at him. Hey,
not you psychos in the chat room that fucking tweet everyone all day long.
Yeah, not you people. No, I'm just talking about the ghosts that live in the audio, that download the audio for this every day, and whoever you people are. Thank you very much.
They're in a shed. They're in a warehouse in Vietnam, like being whipped.
The people don't come in the cavern.
We're paying you $50 a month.
No, actually, no in Vietnam. But I did notice that in the last 2 weeks, and I didn't even know it was called this. The Republic of Italia. It's like. What do you mean, the Republic of not even Italiana or something? I was like, you mean Italy? The Republic of Italiana?
Italy is like the most, they have like a new government like every 6 months. Italy, I mean, I have friends there. I've been there.
In the last 2 weeks, the numbers have been off the charts for Italy. Let me just pull this up really quick and see what. It stunned me. It actually stunned me. Like, what the fuck happened in Italy? I know my name.
Italy's crazy.
My name is pretty big over there because there's like a museum called Napo, which is an acronym for something.
The Matt Napo Museum of Podcasting?
No, no. It's like National Arts and Pedophile People Organization or something.
Arts and Pedophiles, yes.
I'm just putting something. Where is the Italy numbers here? Italy by countries. Yeah. 25,354 downloads this week from the Repubblica Italiana.
You were telling William Conway you had like 20,000 people in fucking Nebraska a week? That fucking shocked. That shocked me. Because I didn't even know, like, I don't know how many people even live there. I think a million.
Every one of you people listening, I have got cancer, and I would like $1 from all of you, please. You can find me on Twitter at @Carl_man, and I'll give you my PayPal. Thank you.
I think I support that grift tremendously, but I think we have to get past this weekend to start that grift.
Shit, the other one, yeah. Let's see. Right.
But what I want to do for this one, because Stanhope put out there that. I don't know. If he were to donate, he would do it anonymously. So if you donate, you should do it under his name. So what I want to do, because we have, if I look at all the people we have on all the lists, if everybody just donated $1 as Doug Stanhope, there'd be twice as much money as the goal, easily. It'd be like $50,000, yeah. $60,000. $1. All it takes is $1 donated under
$1. If anyone doesn't donate anything, you deserve. Okay, I'll talk about this Saturday. Everyone needs to donate $1.
That's
even
right.
If you have to go without one piece of bread for one day, just donate. If you're helping with the show, you're working. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, $1. Yeah. I mean, a dollar. That's not even. I mean, what could you buy for a dollar anyway? You can't buy anything for a dollar. Nothing.
Exactly. You may as well give it.
Arizona iced tea. That's it.
You can buy Arizona iced tea? What, a small one? Like a 6 ounce?
No, a big one. It's still a dollar.
Wow. And I'm rushing right out to get that. Why? Sign them up as sponsorship, will you, Dean? Get on that.
Yeah, Arizona. Dean, if you don't get the Arizona iced tea sponsorship by the end of the day, you're out.
I'm out. We're
going to lose all my guests. We need the money coming in now.
You know, that's what we really need is get some of these corporations to. This is how Jerry Lewis got his.
No, but what about the Portlandia? Portlandia. Does anyone know any of those actors? I don't even like that film because I'm from Portland, so I hated that show. Even though I like Christine Lee.
No, that would be. You're right, and you know what? I didn't reach out to her co-host Frank from the radio show she does in Tucson. He was a bit of a dick to me when I was on his show, so I don't know. But so maybe I thought maybe have him on, and I could like give it back to him and be a dick to him, just to even up the score. Or I could just sick you on him, Dean. I could just like let you at him. You're like
I have that side.
Can we use Dean? I mean, can we use him? I mean, Dean, what are we dealing with here, right? You've talked about it before, right? Now stop me at any time. You do have a disability, right? Long term. Why don't we use you? You go out into the world and say, listen, I'm a podcast host, right? I also have a disability. You should give me lots of money because it's unique and you're helping someone who really needs it. And then we all split it three ways. You're going to have a third more than you would have anyway. We all make it,
yeah.
But you're the face.
You're going to go out and get the
sponsors and just say, look, please.
What are we doing? Are you saying what are we doing? Are you actually questioning what our value, the value we bring to this? We are your managers. We are.
I'm the fluffer,
right?
Are we going to fluff me, Carl?
What we need to do is get Dean on one of those, like the Eddie Murphy thing where he's on the little roller thing in the street where he's pretending to be blind and he's got a cup in his hand, blind and no legs and all that kind of stuff, and put him on the street. And we can get rich that way. And what do we get at? We are your managers, Dean. Everybody needs a manager, and you got
in fact,
two.
When I say you get the money and we'll split it three ways, what we mean is you give us the money, and then we will
we'll give you back what we say.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Don't count it beforehand, right? No.
All right.
Well, you guys, I want to get out of here now because I'm guest.
I just saying hello.
All right. He's not in yet. Wait till his camera turns on. Hang with me until he gets his camera on, because right now he's black. Not that there's anything wrong with being black. It's not a black guy.
He's just dead again.
He's just in the dark.
I'm done.
I know you're done. All right. I'll take you out of here. Carl just left so he could just like ramble on and say all sorts of
I'll stay with you here. Guest arrived.
Yeah, well, he's here. He needs to turn on his camera. Matt, if you're listening, device is not connected. Now he's looking in the back. Matt, if you can hear me, on the bottom of your screen, there's a little tool icon. That says settings. If you click in there, you can select your video settings and then your camera. And then you should be there. He is. He's ready to go. Okay, let me take Dean out. Dean, thanks for filling
some
time.
Thank you so much.
Well, I'll talk to you online later today.
Yes.
All right. Talk to you later. My guest has arrived. Matt Balaker is a comic, a writer, and an informer. Investment manager who's written the book Greg Giraldo, a Comedian Story. He's here now to talk about that book and enlighten some of the people in the chat room, especially about just how great a comedian aforementioned Greg Giraldo was. Let's welcome in Matt Balaker to Coffee with the Dog. Matt, welcome.
Hey, thank you, dog, and thank you, chat room.
Hey, thanks for being here. Now, investment banker. Let's start there, though. You're a money man.
I worked for money men and women. Yes, I took rich people's money and worked hard to make it a little bit more than they had the prior year. So I was doing God's work.
But being a funny guy, is there any humor in the money business?
Oh, yeah. When people try to raise hundreds of millions of dollars on a business that's just a spreadsheet and a prayer, I think it's kind of funny.
There's a lot of that, isn't
it? Yeah, and then they'll show you. You always get projections, dog, where it's like, all right, you know, if you give us, say, $2 million now, in 6 months, it'll be more than that. And then inevitably, it won't work out that way. And you'll call them out, and you'll be like, well, I had a spreadsheet. And so apparently... real business
spreadsheet is for anything anymore. Come on, nobody respects a spreadsheet.
I think it can get you an MBA. It's a fun world, but you know it's not as lucrative as stand up comedy as you would imagine.
Now that's hard to believe.
Cheers.
Now, so are you out of that business altogether?
Yes and no. You know, it keeps pulling me back in like all the best drugs do. Now, I mean, I always like entrepreneurship, and I like helping companies out. So if I see a business that I think is worth funding, I'll work with people to try to get it off the ground. But it's not like I don't have the suits for it. I don't really know how to tie a tie that well. So, you know, I can do it, but kind of peripherally.
I dig it, man. Before we get into the Greg Giraldo stuff here, because you mentioned the word entrepreneurship, and last night on my evening podcast, I had Daniel Madelon, who was is there enough.org, and it's about sustainability and almost 8 billion people on the planet. Is there enough? Is there enough? And we were talking about economics a bit. Part of what he preaches is progressive ideas mixed with capitalism. And I was like, that's such a tough sell, because most progressive people think of capitalism as evil. And then he brought up, well, the question I would ask anybody who feels like capitalism is evil, how they feel about entrepreneurship, because almost everybody loves an entrepreneur and the idea of building something from nothing, and not all that entrepreneurship is capitalism on an individual level.
That's the best. You're a genius, mind dog. Creating something from nothing, I think, is the the essence of entrepreneurship. So you're,
right. Yeah.
You're so wise, young man.
Thank you. Now, Greg Giraldo, I brought it up to the chat room. Big comedy fans in the chat room. And surprising that there's not a whole lot of knowledge about Greg Giraldo, because I, in my view, he's one of the most influential comics of the last 40 years or so. And for me, you know, he's up, I say this a lot, but he's up there like Mount Rushmore of comedy to me in a lot of ways. What was it that got you inspired to write the book about him?
Kind of for the reasons you just mentioned. I mean, I didn't formally create a Mount Rushmore, but if I was going to do that, he'd be up there probably with Pryor. I mean, we'd have to take Bill Cosby down, but maybe we could replace him with Bill Burr, something like that. But definitely, Giraldo was up there. And this was, gosh, about 7-8 years ago when I still had a day job, you know, before I was this hugely successful podcaster, you know, where I had to, you know, go into work sometimes. And I was at break, and I went on Amazon because I wanted to buy a book about Greg Giraldo. I just figured, you know, it had been a few years since he passed, you know, some idiot must have written one. And lo and behold, there wasn't one. So I was the idiot that was going to write it. So I think it was one of those kind of like what you mentioned. I think objectively, and it's hard to be objective about stand-up, but he was so good. And it would, to me, it would be like if there was never a book or a movie about Kurt Cobain, because in my opinion, he was sort of the Kurt Cobain of stand-up comedy in the early 2000s.
That's a good analogy, I think. Very, very astute analogy. Are you surprised that he's not more among the, I know among comedians, he's for working comedians in America especially, he is so well respected. But are you surprised, like, there are you, again, chat room here is comedy fans, and they weren't really all that familiar with him. Does that surprise you?
Yes and no. I mean, even during his career, it wasn't like he was selling out stadiums. And I think there's lots of reasons for that. It's like he may have not had the best publicist. And admittedly, he wasn't really good at marketing. Like, he just liked to get into clubs, tell jokes. And he worked hard at the joke writing and performing. But he wasn't one of these guys who would, you know, email 1,000 bookers a day or work with his manager to make sure he was maximizing every moment of his time. I mean, he also had some addiction issues that probably derailed some of his career success. But I think it's, yeah, just that's a theory we have that, you know, it's not quite tested. We had
But like
a lot
you.
Of artists, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry. I thought you were done.
I mean, much like yourself, I mean, you're brilliant at what you do. And there are people who are unfamiliar with your work. And it's a tragedy, but it's a reality we live in.
Well, thank you for that. I don't think there's anybody that's not familiar with me.
That's true. Bad example.
Because they know me by my other name, Joe Rogan. I don't know if have you heard him?
Now it rings a bell. I think you lift weights and wrestle or something.
It's a Groucho glasses and mustache that fool everybody. I'm just Joe Rogan. Now he started out, Giraldo started out, I think, like going to be a lawyer or something, right?
He was a lawyer. He had a very similar academic path from a guy who had a job in the White House, Barack Obama. Like, he went to Columbia undergrad and then Harvard Law School. And incidentally, Giraldo scored higher on his LSATs, allegedly, than the former president. And so he got a job at Skadden Arps in New York City, which in the law world, that's even a bigger deal than the Harvard degree. I mean, especially at the time, it was like kind of the Rolls Royce or the Mind Dog TV of law firms. You know, it was like the top of the top. And he gave it a go for a solid 8-9 months before leaving big law.
So he never made big money in it. 8-9 months, you don't really have the opportunity to really become a billionaire.
Not a billionaire, but his salary, I think he was hired in 1990, maybe 1991. Don't quote me on that, but it's one of those years. And his salary was about $85,000-$87,000, which in today's dollars is close to, it's like 200 plus, like maybe, let's call it 240 something with inflation. And so, I mean, you could definitely live comfortably, even in New York City. And so he's not like this comic who passed up a job selling weed to high school kids or something. You know, he had like a very lucrative career path, and he gave it up for stand up.
Right. Now, when you were, did you know any of the comedians that you interviewed for the book before you did?
I knew a handful of them. For instance, like Jesse Joyce, who was his opener for a few years. I knew him casually, like we'd done some shows together. And actually, a woman I was very close, still am, Kareth Foster, who wasn't kind of cut her teeth in New York, then moved to LA. And that's where I met her doing stand-up. Kareth was really instrumental in introducing me to people like Rick Dorfman, who was Greg's manager. And then ultimately, like for instance, like Colin Quinn, I didn't know him personally, but I'd seen him enough times in New York. And I watched him on Tough Crowd pretty much every day, where I felt like I knew him. So when I finally got the chance to talk to him, you know, I had some hopefully insightful things to ask.
Now, do you keep in touch with any of them?
when I want something from them, I'm a really good friend. You know, if I need a retweet or sales are dipping a little. I mean, yeah, like the ones I was friends with before, like Kareth Foster, I do. And Jesse was helpful. Like he and I did a Jeff Ross's show when the book came out, and that was cool. You know, it spread the word. And like for instance, there's a documentary that Vice is doing that's going to come out later. I guess it's going to be in September 27th. So when that comes out, I'm going to hit up some of the comics to hopefully get tweets or you know just spread the word that there's more Giraldo news on the horizon.
Did Ross give an endorsement for the book at all, or you know, in some any
way? He said it was the best thing ever written since the Torah and the Bible. I think that was his endorsement. No, he did. Yeah,
both of those books are kind of fictional, though. Yours is more true to life, isn't it?
You know, I don't want to get philosophical or religious here, but yeah. he did give it an endorsement. In fact, he had me on the show. He was one of the first, actually, because this shows how much pull I had in showbiz. I started a Kickstarter campaign to raise money for it. I thought I needed like $3,000. Turns out I needed a lot more. But Jeff Ross, unbeknownst to me, retweeted my Kickstarter link, and so before I knew it, I raised like $5,000, which, you know, inevitably I needed more, but I didn't know that. But it was enough to kind of get the project rolling. So thank you, Jeff Ross. You're a good human.
Wow, that's cool. Now you mentioned this was on Saturday. We are doing a fundraiser for Christine Levine, who was on Portlandia. She's a comedian, stand-up comedian, and. It's our second Podathon that we're doing. Podathon is just my word for a podcasting telethon fundraiser. But people, we were talking this morning about people who were on the first one and why I haven't asked them. Kind of the same thing that you just said is like, I feel like the only time I reach out to them is when I need something from them, and I don't want to be known. Oh, here comes the pest again. Like, he's just going to ask me for a favor. This is a guy who just takes and never gives.
Just takes and takes. A friend in need is a friend indeed, they say.
Yeah. So I'm cognizant of that and don't want to. That's why I didn't ask a lot of the same people that were on. We did a 40-hour one for Andy Andrus back in
January.
40-hour continuous, yeah. This one's only going to be like 12.
That's a feat. That's impressive.
It was. We were going for the Guinness World Record until I found out. Well, first of all, they wanted to charge me $25,000 to list the as a world record, which was like, you know what? We're not even raising $25,000.
Yeah, yeah. That's bad economics. You're smart.
But I found out that a friend of mine, John Pavaramo, did a 96-hour continuous podcast with And he's got some heavy hitters on that. And I was just like, how many days is that? It's like 4 days or something.
Yeah, did you ask him why?
Yeah. Why? For cystic fibrosis.
Okay, well then, like, I guess like 95 hours wouldn't cut it. He needed to go.
Right.
He needed that last one to...
I wonder how much money. I never asked them how much money they raised in 96 hours, but it better been worth it. Because if not,
might have been that for two cups of coffee.
I'm just thinking, if not, you could go get a minimum wage job at like Dunkin' Donuts or McDonald's or something and make that much money in 96 hours.
You definitely can. Yeah.
Did you get Artie Lang to talk about? Is he quoted at all in the book with any stories?
He's referenced. Artie was going through some personal issues, I think, at the time, because I reached out a handful of times to him and his people, but I never got an interview. But I know that since then he's doing a lot better. And but he has this story that actually wasn't in the book, but it was pretty cool. I think it was in one of Artie's own books. Is before the William Shatner roast. Greg was on a bender, and actually Jesse Joyce, who was kind of in a sense his sober coach. I mean, he wasn't literally a sober coach, but he was also sober and would tour with Greg, went to Greg's apartment like 6 days before the roast and said something to the effect of like, oh, it's tomorrow, we got to get you to LA. And he even like changed the calendar in his room to like kind of sell the ruse. And then so they didn't even like pack a full suitcase. They just threw a couple shirts and stuff in a bag and went to the airport. And apparently it was Artie that then like took him on the airplane and was like the caretaker. You know, Artie was the sober companion, making sure Greg didn't drink too much or, you know, indulge too many vices. And then when they got to LA, it was because Jesse broke the news the next day, like, well, I got something to tell you, Greg. The roast isn't for like 5 days. And at first, Giraldo was pissed, but then he realized like what a good opportunity it was. So Artie and Jesse kind of worked together to get Greg on track for the Hasselhoff roast, which I think is one of the best ones he ever did. I mean, I'm biased. I think they're all the best, but there was a line, I don't know if you saw it, where Greg references Artie Lang and he goes, "Artie, you fat drug addict," and then kind of like give him a shrug. And this was the time when Artie was sober and helping Greg. I thought that was pretty classic.
Yeah, that's a classic story. I mean, basically, and Artie tells that story. It's an hour long story when Artie tells it. But
okay, well, actually delete mine because I'm sure I butchered it, and just put Artie's in because I think he did a better job.
No, it's too long, but it is funny. It's funny as hell, and it. There are so many. I mean, that is real life. Mm-hmm. But now, I don't want to skip to the end now. But Giraldo,
no,
when he
he's no longer with us. You can say it.
When he died, was it a heroin overdose that killed him?
Well, again, you're going to have to buy Greg Giraldo a comedian story, but it was a combination.
It's in the link, and it's in the description going by on the bottom for people who want to buy the book and get it.
Yeah,
right,
it was. You know, I mean, this shows what a good salesman I am. I mean, I really don't think people buy the book to learn
how he died. How I mean, we died, could look that up on the internet.
It was a combo of alcohol and pills.
Wow.
I think Oxycontin. So boys and girls out there, don't mix opioids with booze. It's a bad cocktail. No, it was really sad because it's one of those things, like, you know, I learned more about addiction through this, but I'm certainly no expert, but you can do the right thing 99% of the time, mind dog. And then you have one slip up at a weekend in New Jersey and that's the end of you. And I'm not saying he only had one slip up, but it shows just how difficult it is. And I have so much respect for people who kind of work to maintain sobriety when, you know, when they have those afflictions. It's just a bit.
No, I know all too well and all too closely, and I don't want to get into that and bum everybody out. But people I know who died from overdoses who were experts in how to avoid dying from an overdose. I mean, they almost could have been pharmacologists or sure, you know, put their mind to, because they knew so much about every kind of drug. And still end up overdosing and dying. So
yeah, well, I mean, how? Gosh, who was it? Someone close to Greg? I'm blanking on the person's name, but said how he died was the least interesting thing about him.
Yeah.
What was valuable was his humanity and his comedy. And I was like, that's pretty like prophetic, because lots of people, sadly, are addicts.
Yeah.
Not as many people can make thousands or millions of people laugh. And Greg was also such a good mentor to young comics. And I think it's easy to get hung up on what took him out, but hopefully there's going to be some, you know, a couple dozen people out there who maybe didn't know about Greg Giraldo's work, who might go on YouTube or might watch this, this upcoming
or get
documentary.
The book.
Yeah. I mean, or they can
there's
get
a book about it, you know.
It's if you don't like reading, you can listen. So if you're an illiterate, you can get the Audible version. We've got you,
because that was going to be the next question, because I know my audience always asks, is there an Audible version? I don't know why people don't appreciate the art of reading anymore, but or the skill.
You can listen to it on the subway. In fact, we got the guy who read for the book. It was a native New Yorker, and he sounds a little bit like Greg to me. So I like the audio version, so check that out, people.
Our friend William Conway says he hosted for Artie Lang years ago in Sioux Falls. Got to grab a bite to eat with him and feature. Wow, that's pretty
cool. Very cool.
Have you got to work with people that were in Giraldo's life since writing the book?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, that's what I wanted to get out of this, was a few more minutes of stage time at some dank.
You greedy bastard. Like, no, I...
Can I get a feature
no
weekend?
No judgment here, man. No, I get it.
It has helped. Like, for instance, when we did a release party, gosh, this was in June of 2019, it kind of just came together at the last minute, but we did a show at the Fat Black Pussycat, which is a sister club to the Comedy Cellar. And Dave Attell was there, and Jim Norton. And I love Dave Attell. I mean, like, you can make a really good argument he's the best to do it. Or if you say that, I'm not going to dismiss anyone. And Colin Quinn, and I think I mentioned Jim Norton, was Godfrey there? Well, anyhow, a lot of these comics I just really looked up to, and I emceed it, and it wasn't intended to be like a stand-up show, but it kind of evolved into that. And Greg's widow, Marianne, and his three kids were there. And so while I wasn't like working, like in that I didn't get like a paycheck for it, it was one of those things I'll remember on my deathbed if I'm lucid enough to to remember things. You know, so there was a handful of these people that I admired so much. And because of a work I helped create, I was able to be part of this night. And so since then, yeah, when I've done shows, I can reference them and they'll help me. But it was really that evening that it felt so rewarding. That was really a special time for me.
All those people you just were talking about, I don't know how to express this, but I feel like, and I'm showing the cover of the book there for people on the audio side. Greg Giraldo, comedian story. It's Matt Balaker and Wayne Jones. I'm not familiar with Wayne, but I'll ask about him in a minute. But the people you were just mentioning, I'm really at a loss for how to express the feeling I have about them. That group, you know, Giraldo and Gilbert and Colin Quinn and all that group of and Attell and
Patrice,
Tim Norton, all of those people. Yeah. That was, I don't know if golden age of stand-up comedy is appropriate there, but to me, you know, there's eras in comedy, and you have the Pryor and Carlin era.
Right.
But then that era, to me, maybe it's because it was right in the middle of my life, that it just feels like we'll never see anything that special with so many great influential comedians ever again. Do you have that same reverence that I
do? No, I think you said it perfectly. I mean, there are eras in comedy, and I wasn't here for, like, Lenny Bruce. But obviously he had a huge mark. Pryor was like the GOAT. But the group you're mentioning, I'll call it maybe like the 9/11 crew, for lack of a better word, because I think it was the attacks that kind of galvanized the city and then ultimately the country. But when you watch Tough Crowd, and that's how a lot of people outside of kind of the tri-state area, learned about lots of these comics. It kind of gave them a voice. And it's something that I think, sadly, right now, I don't think they could get away with saying what they did back then. And this isn't like eons ago. It was like 20 years ago or whatever, you know, like, but it was a time when I think the city needed like this kind of raw, brash comedy, and they delivered, and they delivered brilliantly.
Right. Attell is my everyman because mm-hmm. he's from Long Island. He's from Rockville Center, Long Island, I believe. As far as if you know anything about Long Island culture, Dave Attell represents us better. You know, people like to talk about Billy Joel. Dave Attell is the Long Island guy.
Yeah, Dave Attell wasn't married to Christy Brinkley, so he can't represent all Long Islanders.
Right. And he just represents my people in a way that is so real. He's my kind of Moby Dick, the white whale that I need to get an interview with as soon as I
come on. Attell. Rumor has it that Giraldo's passing really motivated Attell to kind of curtail his lifestyle. Like I don't know his personal like how much he drank or you know what other vices, but it's my understanding that, I mean, he looks good now and he's still with us, that this was kind of Giraldo's passing was an eye-opening moment for Attell. And, you know, I obviously it was terrible when it passed, but it's so nice when people can experience a tragedy and improve their lives.
Right. And you know what? It sounds cold-hearted to say that everything happens for a reason, and some I forget where the movie quote is from, but it's just like some stars are so bright they can't help but burn out. They were, right. And I think Giraldo and Richard Jenny kind of fall into that. They were just so white hot for a short period of time that it was bound to burn out. You just can't be that.
Yeah, you're just throwing out insights. Are you always so smart, or is it just because I'm on the show? It's a COVID talking. It's making you smarter, I guess. I think you hit on something important. It's like the value of downtime.
Right.
I mean, maybe I do too much downtime, but like Richard Jenny and Giraldo, they're kind of just like going full throttle all the time. And right. then when, at least in Giraldo's case, you'd have the occasional bender, but it seems like, you know, people that chill out for a while, I mean, heck, maybe it's yoga, maybe it's just going to the beach. I don't know, just doing something to kind of recenter yourself and calm down, I think is so important to longevity.
Yeah. Tell me a little bit about Wayne Jones, your co-author, close friend.
I guess I feel obligated. No. Yeah. Wayne is a great human being. As I mentioned earlier, I had to do a Kickstarter campaign to raise funds for the book. And when I was like a few hundred bucks away from the goal, I got an email from some Canadian saying, you know, I want to make sure it goes over the top. This is really important to me that it gets done. I was like, it's really important to you. That's cool. And then he mentioned that he worked as an academic librarian. So long story less long, he contributed a big chunk of money. And one of the reasons I was raising money and I put on the website is co-author, because I had written some stuff and I wrote for my high school paper, but you know, I'd never written like a novel before. And I knew there was all these like citations and reference issues and blah, blah, blah. And so a few weeks after closing the Kickstarter campaign, I put some feelers out there to authors. And then I remember that Wayne had writing experience. And then I asked if he wanted to do it. And he was like, do I? Like, of course. And his enthusiasm was infectious. And I was like, damn, okay. Like, I didn't think you'd be so on board. And so I think it was because of him ultimately that the book was made, because there were periods where, you know, I had a new baby, you know, work sucked. There's the usual highs and lows of life. But because I had someone else out there kind of pushing me, and we pushed each other, it really got us past the finish line. So Wayne, he is a Canadian. I won't hold that against him, but yeah, he applied his academic knowledge to help make the book happen. So thank you, Wayne.
My alter ego Joe says that, well, all those Canadians are communists anyway. So
that's true. Well, he's a communist who's good at citations, and I know I got some pushback from people, but like it seems like a quarter of the book at the end is all references, and most of this, Mind Dog, is just to prevent me from getting sued.
Because
of course lawyers get their dirty fingers in books as well, and you have to make sure you appropriately cite. Especially celebrities and stuff that you mentioned, so you don't get sued.
So let's talk about, and I'm hoping the answer is no, there was none of this. But my experience is when I talk to comedians, I will get a story out of one, and then I repeat it to another one who was kind of around at the same time and say, no, that was
BS.
That's,
yeah.
Did you get any of that?
There were a few that... it just made me question memories, you know, because there's one. It's not super consequential, Mind Dog, but one was during Greg's like first day at law school, his second year. One swore that he was there to help move him in, and then another person was like, "No, he wasn't even there for 2 days." So it was like it wasn't like a version of a story. It just neither could have even existed, and it happened like 30 plus years ago. So it made me think, like, when people are on trial or they're being interviewed for like the Supreme Court, or I don't know, somewhere like we're asking questions like 30 years ago, they might really think certain things happened and they didn't. And also, people like to make themselves the center of a story, even if it's talking about someone else. So inevitably, there, you know, someone would say, "Oh, this guy did pretty well opening for Greg," and then you interview the person, "Oh, I had a killer set, the audience loved me." So I mean, there's always some kind of window dressing based on the person telling the story.
Oh, I get that completely. I have a memoir coming out, and I'm calling it a semi-fictional memoir only because of that issue that I'm pretty sure the stories I'm telling are true, but when I reference them to other people I know who were there, it's always slightly different. It's like, whose memory is right here about exactly how things happen? So, yeah, I totally get that. I don't think people are intentionally trying to mislead people.
Right.
I think a lot of memories can be flawed. And the more you kind of, every time you remember something, you're rebuilding it in your mind. And sometimes you tell a story and then whatever things work their way into there, you don't, not even sure how they got there.
Absolutely, yeah. And in each year, more things get there that might have not actually happened.
Yeah, so that's just curious. And I know a lot of people, that's why I brought it up, because some comedians get really angry if you get the story different than they have it. And like, no, that's not right. Like, it might be, maybe. Yeah,
Take it easy, man. Yeah.
Somebody, and we're not talking about life and death issues here.
We're not, right. Like, do you want this heart transplant or not?
Yeah. So it's your, let me just answer this comment because this is something business here. Valentina, yeah, I would love to talk to you about, networking and sharing guests and all that kind of stuff. Contact me at info@minddogtv.com. Thanks for getting in touch.
What? You're networking while you're hosting.
Yes, I am.
Multitasking.
It's my life, man. I love what I'm doing with just doing this for a living. This is my entire life, podcasting, 2 shows a day. And well, it's not my entire life. I also
life play well led. If you do nothing else, you can hang your hat knowing you contributed.
And I'm out gigging, which is leads me to my question about you. Now, do you have focus right now, stage time and doing shows and comedy?
At night, yeah, I have 2 kids who are probably screaming in the background. So my focus during the day is them. But at night, you know, someone's got to tell dick jokes, and I want to be the one to do it.
So now, is this a challenge? Because this is a kind of a thing that having a family and being a stand-up comedian or a musician or anybody in...
Yeah, don't recommend it. Don't. It's bad. Yeah. You know, bad for your career.
Difficult thing to manage, though, and keep your life together with that. I mean, it could be bad for your career, but it could also be bad for your family, right?
I mean, yeah, the career would be bad for your family, but my number one piece of advice for you know, non super famous comedians is marry well. Yeah. I have a good wife, and she has a steady paycheck, so that allows me to you know, to do shows like this. But I mean that, like, if you have someone who's supportive, and it's hard to find. Like, I think 99% of how I got her is luck. It makes your career path, or I don't even want, it's almost more of a vocation, I think, because stand-up's just a horrible thing that, you know, you do it because you love it. And I almost wish I didn't like it so much. I mean, you probably know, you know, a lot yeah. of comics have that. It's not like a job where you punch in and punch out. It's like something that, like, you're neurotic if you don't do it. And if you do it, you're maybe 5% less neurotic.
Yep. I'm just gonna, Jamie, I hope you're listening to that. That was some profound advice. I'm just going to add that big part of it is being honest. You know, you mentioned luck, and that's there's a couple of things. Luck and finding the right person who's going to be supportive of you throughout that. Being honest with them of this is who you are. Don't expect me to be anything but this at some point. You don't want any surprises. That's important. But also recognizing when you're lucky enough. When I'm on my second marriage now, but when I was young, I was married to a woman who took an active role in my career. And she was like a manager. She was also a co-producer. And I hated that. At the time, because I grew up in the era of the Beatles, and I didn't want a Yoko Ono in the studio yeah. with me. And
not many people wanted a Yoko, yeah.
But now, after 20 years of being divorced, I was like, you know what? I was stupid. I was blind. Most people would kill to have somebody who's that supportive of them, that takes that much interest in them, that this is the family business, and she's going to see it through like it was her thing. Like, what a dope I was, you know. That's important to recognize when you have found somebody that you know will.
Yeah, and I'd like to say, oh, if you do A, B, and C, you'll find that person. I mean, I know plenty of good people that you find someone, and then she's not, you know, she's psycho 2 years later or something like that. You know, it happens.
Right.
But it's a lot of it's luck. I wish it was more profound, but I don't think it is.
So with. I'm going to come back to stand-up comedy, but with that being your goal now, are you looking to maybe write more books about comedians? Have you found?
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to write more books. I mean, there was one comic who I thought is a really, really big name, and it looked like I was going to pen his biography, and then it didn't happen. I don't want to say it because if they ever circle back. And so I've thought about it, but I don't know if I can say it, but no one's listening. No, there's some people who are trying to adapt this to a movie, and I'm helping with that. So
well,
on
that's
one hand,
what
like
I was going to be what next, cause it sounds like, and let me back up here. Now I've talked to so many comedians, and I talked about this, I think earlier in the show before you got here today, that, so many comedians talk about films about stand-up comedy in a very negative light. Like there's never been one that's true that actually shows the reality of stand-up comedy from a stand-up comedian's perspective. And in the Giraldo book, I'm thinking this is about as real as it gets. This could be a movie that maybe the public doesn't go crazy over it, but it will gain the immense respect of the 10 billion comedians who are working right now, calling themselves.
It used to be, I mean, you probably remember, it was like New York, Boston, LA, Seattle. I mean, they're like kind of major hubs of stand-up. Now, there's no coffee house in America where there's not an open mic night. So right. I think comedians outnumber regular humans 3.5 to 1. I think that's the ratio
yeah.
right now. So if we can get a movie about a working comic, like there was the Seinfeld one, which I really liked, but at the time he made it, he was a gazillionaire. Right. So I think Jerry Seinfeld's experience was very different than Greg Giraldo's. And Giraldo's material is just so damn good. Like when I was reading the script, the writers did an excellent job of keeping a lot of his original material. I mean, they had to write some of their own, which was kind of cool in a way, but like Giraldo's stuff is just so damn funny. Like you could just have clips of that and it would be worth watching. You know, hopefully there's more to it, but he was, it's kind of trite to say, but he was a comics comic. So if we can kind of encapsulate that in a movie, there's going to be a lot of comedy geeks who will be happy about it.
Yeah, it would be very cool. And, you know, to your point, though, I mean, I order breakfast and the Uber driver pulls up, and as I'm tipping him, he's telling me about his upcoming stand-up gig.
He's like, I need 14 friends there. The show starts at 6:18 p.m. Can you be there 4 hours early?
What about that from your perspective? I always say that, and I think I'm wrong when I say that the universe will take care of the bad comics. But I see people now, I don't want to mention names, people who've been doing it 10 years, and I have to give them comedy advice about what they're doing wrong. It's like, I have to tell you what you're doing wrong, and you've been calling yourself a professional comedian for 10 years. You have never been a professional comedian, if I can spot the holes.
You have to be kind of delusional to get on stage initially. Because, I mean, no one's great at first, but you have to think you're worthwhile enough to be on stage. So it's this strange dynamic. I call it, it's like a blend of insecurity and narcissism.
Right.
You know, you're trying to entertain people, but you also feel like, why am I here? But if you're not narcissistic enough to grab the mic, you're never going to do it in the first place.
Right. But now I agree with you completely. But after 10 years, if you haven't figured out that you can't just fill a sentence with F-bombs and make that funny, and you need me to tell you that, I mean, that's a lesson you should learn in your first year. And I've seen people who've been in it 10 years and say, and they can't say a sentence without four or five F-bombs in it. It's like, wow.
Yeah.
People can't laugh. You're taking the power.
Send them a thesaurus or something. Maybe say frick or fudge. I don't know.
I think it's an insecurity with the material. I don't remember it. I'm nervous. All that. Every time I see that,
I think it's a nervous tick. You drop F bombs because it's like you're filling space.
Right. Exactly. And now I think that's a lesson that you should learn very fairly if it takes you 10 years.
Right. I mean, obviously not in like Giraldo or Tell's case, but it's a good challenge. Like, I got a lot more pay, you know, better paying work when I agreed to do clean shows.
Right.
And to me, I can go TV clean. I can't go G, but I can do a set without cussing. And when I was in my 20s or something, I'd think, oh, how can that ever be good? But it's a worthwhile challenge. Like even Giraldo, he did plenty of sets that were TV clean that were hilarious. So I think it's a good thing to try.
Yeah. Well, when it comes to that, I don't think that you I think you can do a really funny stuff without ever getting profane. And you can still be adult in your comedy without being profane. I think the problem for some people, because you talk about the money issue, problem for some people is they try to do a clean show even though they really are Robert Smigel, you know, and like really, really dirty at the core. But because the money is so good, I'm going to try dry bar comedy or something like that. And you could tell how...
Yeah, I mean, there's a point.
Yeah.
I can't see Paul Mooney doing dry bar.
Right, yeah. You have to be authentic to yourself and realize no matter how good the money is, if that's not you, don't do it.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. So where are you working now? You got gigs lined up that you want to promote? Well,
we're promoting the book. Tustin's 17th Street Bar and Grill, September. Actually, tonight, Oceanside, California, Jazzy Wishbone. So people who are in New York right now, maybe go to LaGuardia or something, get a flight to San Diego, and then drive to Oceanside. I'll be there at 7:30 tonight. And I guess one thing to promote, the Vice special is coming out September 27th. It's called The Dark Side of Comedy. Obviously I encourage people to check out the book, but go to YouTube, Google Greg Giraldo, ask comics who are a little bit older, what was he like? His material stands up now. So just check him out. And I have a podcast. Sorry. It's all the other names were taken. It's called the Matt Balaker podcast. So we're looking for good guests. We're looking for subscribers. Please check us out.
Now, what kind of, I'm not familiar with it. So, what is it? Interviews of,
yeah. We interview leaders in business, comedy, and publishing in hopes of free riding off their knowledge. So we'd love to have you on, too.
Well, that would be wonderful. Now, my challenge, because when I first started this, I wanted to just interview comedians, but there weren't enough of them who were willing to come on. So I started doing authors and filmmakers and scientists and teachers and all that stuff on my evening show. But to make it pay, I also had a afternoon edition that was the business edition, business leaders and money people and all this stuff. And the morning show is now like people think of me as like kind of a shock jock of podcasting. But where I segmented my audience, like, because it's under comedy, and sometimes they tune in for comedy, and I got an author interview, like, well, this isn't comedy. And so I think
there's
hurt
no
me.
F-bombs. It's not
yeah.
funny.
Yeah. So what you were just talking about, leadership and is there a continuous audience, like a congruent audience that fills all of that?
Probably not.
Yeah.
But I'm going to try to find it. But it's generally people I like interviewing. And I think if you're passionate about something, hopefully the audience will follow. But kind of like you were saying, it's authentic to what I want to do. And if it doesn't work, I'll go down doing what I want to do.
That's kind of where I am too, Matt. And I hope we're right.
Me too.
Because every like super successful podcaster will tell me that's the wrong way to go. You got to niche down. You got to have a complete solid niche. So like you're a McDonald's cheeseburger. People know exactly what they're going to get every time. It's like, I don't want to be a McDonald's cheeseburger. I hate fucking McDonald's.
I'm at least a Wendy's, please.
Yeah. Give me some lettuce and tomato or
exactly.
something. Yeah. This has been... No, I... do me a favor. When the Vice thing comes out, send me a reminder so I will tell people about it. But to your point about people going to LaGuardia, surprisingly enough, a big segment, much bigger than my local area here, of my audience is West Coast, Arizona and California in particular, Vegas. Got a lot of people out there that, and I know it's very early for people out there. It's very early for you, and I appreciate that.
Oh, my pleasure. But yeah, for West Coast people, especially if you have like a venue or now that, you know, COVID is more under control, love to do some shows. You know,
Do you go all over California
and West Coast, you know, and now, as I said, my kids are older, so I can just give them an iPad and they're fine for a few weeks. So
I think everybody in Sacramento listens to this show. I do.
Hit me up, Sacramento.
Yeah, yeah. Get him up there.
Go to mattbalaker.com and click contact.
Oh, mattbalaker.com. I look at the Amazon thing. Can you get the Giraldo book there at Matt?
Yeah,
Balaker?
I believe so. Yeah.
I will put that in the description. Thanks. I didn't even look for your name. I was just looking for links to the book. The link to the book. I'll show the book one more time. We'll plug it one more time before we say goodbye. It's Greg Giraldo, Comedian Story by Matt Balaker and Wayne Jones. It's available at Amazon today. You can also get it in audio version. And is there a Kindle also?
Yeah.
All right. There you go, man. You're all set. Get the book. Find out about the fabulous Greg Giraldo so you can stop being dumb about one of the greatest comedians who ever lived, in my view, anyway. Matt, it's been a pleasure to get to know you. Thank you so much for being part of the show.
Thank you so much for having me. Really appreciate it.
All right. Stay in touch. And please do send me anything that when it's coming out, the Vice thing when it's coming out. But if you have shows in particular, you don't have to be here for me to plug them. I will definitely help get the word out.
Anything really appreciate it. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks. Have a great day. Bye for now.
You too.
Bye. Matt Balaker, folks, I hope you get the book. I hope that inspires you. To learn more about the fabulous Greg Giraldo. I have a couple minutes left before I have to say goodbye to Govs. The link there is again, and then mattbalaker.com. I will put that link in the description. Let me pull that link out of the scroll across. So what'd you think, folks? Did you like that interview? Was it good for you? Do you need a cigarette? Let me catch up with some of these... Again, Valentina, if you're still there, please write to me at info@minddogtv.com. Maybe we could talk about some things like that. Long Island-based, eh? Long Island Breakfast Club. what is Williams saying? I like to be the lead in a Robin Williams bio. No. No. Are you being serious about that? I love you, William. I love you. I think you're a funny guy. I don't know if you could pull off. Maybe you can. Have you done any acting? Because Robin Williams is such an over-the-top character that will require so much energy. I think you would have to become a cocaine addict just to act like him. I do. Or maybe speed of some kind. So, and I'm not saying crystal meth. But you'd have to be on something just to keep up that frenetic energy level for even 10 minutes to shoot a short scene. I mean, the guy was, I know he did dabble in drugs, did a lot of cocaine when he was young. I think he was in Belushi's bungalow the night Belushi passed. So, I mean, no stranger to drugs, obviously. But just incredible over-the-top amount of energy that seemed impossible to sustain on a drug-free life. Anyway, that's the show for you today. I'm saying bye to Govs now. Bye, Govs. That's the show for you today. Jackie will be with me tomorrow. I think Jess will be with me tomorrow. No evening show tonight. My guest, guess what? Canceled. But rescheduled, not canceled. Had some emergency come up and contacted me last night. So this is not a late last-minute canceling. And it's actually a fortuitous thing because, as you know, I'm working on this Saturday thing, and it frees me up to put some energy. William's saying I've done coke one time accidentally for 3 months. Yeah, 3 years, 3 months. What's the difference, right? Where was I? Oh, so no show tonight. Be back tomorrow with Jackie, at least, possibly Jess. And that will be that. And then we'll be with you starting Saturday morning. We're still tying up the details. If I haven't sent you links, your guest link, and you're on the show yet, please remind me. I'm going to have to go through the list and make sure everybody has their links and all that kind of stuff. But looking forward to Saturday. Thanks for all your help. And that's the show for today. You know where to find me if anything comes up or any questions, comments, all that kind of stuff. So just remember to, what do you have to do? Oh, yeah, turn on your radio.
to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.